Hello everybody. Welcome fellow mapmakers to tonight's live mapmaking session. Nice to see you back. Nice to be back here. I'm Ralf Schermann of Profantasy Software, and tonight I want to show you a bit of our perspectives add-on and create a isometric floor plan and building from an existing floor plan that we actually drew last week. So I hope you'll enjoy that and learn a little bit about a little more advanced features of Campaign Cartographer. So to start out, let's load up the map we created last week. So I just, one thing I wanted to mention before I forget. This time, because we are using a little more of the advanced features, I'll not be going through all the different areas of our interface. I'm assuming that you know most of that. But instead, I'll try to be a bit more detailed when selecting commands and using the toolbars actually, and mention what they are during the drawing of the building I'm doing. So to start off, I've clicked on the file toolbar and the open file button, and that gives me my Windows Explorer where I can look up all the old maps and files I've done before. So I'm gonna look in here, and here I've got the ground floor of the temple we did last week. Let's turn on sheet effects. Again, I'm clicking on the properties toolbar up here and to open the sheets dialog, and that lets me activate sheets here. Click OK, and there you can see the proper outline of the floor plan with the walls and everything. So converting this into a 3D map, an isometric map, seems like a pretty daunting task at first, but actually the perspectives add-on makes it fairly easy. I'll be copying stuff over from one map into another, and for that I like to open two instances of Campaign Cartographer. So you can run multiple instances of the of CC3+ on the same computer. So I'm just gonna start up CC3+ again. And let me grab the interface and put it on the correct screen. Here we are. And here I'm going to start the new map I want to create. I go to the file toolbar up here, and this is the new map button I'm using. I'll click on that, and that gives me the new drawing wizard. And this week I'm going to start out by choosing the map type perspectives. That's from our perspectives 3 add-on. Click next, and then I get different styles for that. And basically perspectives comes with two bitmap styles and the old vector style. And I'm quite fond of the Herven V-Link perspective style, so I'm going to use that for our temple we are creating. And for the size of the map, so I'm wondering what was the size of the map we were creating originally. So let's just go back to our other map and have a look. How big is this? See, we've got the grid on here, but I don't have a scale bar on, so I might not know how much a grid square is. So I can just go up to the menu and click on info, and here I have the distance command, which let me check the distance between two points. So let's see the width of our temple from this point to this, and is 60 feet, and in the north-south direction it's the same thing, 60 feet each way. So that's what we need to fit on our new map. And I'm gonna go back there, and so I wanted have some room outside of the wall, so I'll say 100 feet by 100 feet for our new map. And I'll just click finish at that point and save the map. Let's call it Temple of Isis Isometric. And here's our blank map. And the first thing I want to do is I want to add a grid to the map. Perspectives isometric maps always, it's much easier working for them if you have a grid that you can refer to, because the isometric direction of stuff is not easily done by hand. So I'm going to go up to the menu again, choose draw, and then hex or square overlay. And this time I'm actually going to choose an isometric overlay. That's its own type of grid. And I'm going to choose a 5-foot grid spacing. I don't need any labels on the grid. And I'll leave the set snap grid option on. That means my snap grids, where my mouse cursor jumps to when I use the snap function, will be set matching the new grid. And here's my isometric grid. You see these diamond shapes or angles. That's how a isometric drawing is set up. All right, so we've got our grid and the fresh map. Now we need the base for our temple. I go back to the old map. And I'm going to use the clipboard to copy the stuff over that I want. So I'm going to go to the menu again, choose Edit, and choose Copy. I could just do Control Copy as well, but I wanted to show you the menu option here. And then I'm going to select my floor plan. I don't need the title or the links box down there on the right, so I'm just going to choose that. And I also don't want the grid, so I'm going to right click and say combine, and I not, because I don't want the grid. So click not and then select the grid, and it gets deselected. Then I'm going to right click and choose do it. And I'm going to, as the clipboard origin, the point the entities will be inserted in the new map, I choose a corner of the floor plan I have that I can easily select again. So I'm going to choose the lower left corner here. Turned on the snap button before, so I exactly hit the corner here. Click that. And now all the floor plan is in my clipboard. So I'm going to switch back with Alt Tab to the other instance and going to do Edit, Paste or Control V. See, there's the outline of the entities I'm pasting into the map, and I'm going to put them off to the side of the map, because this is going to be my reference stuff, and it's not going to be in the actual drawing area later. There we go, and there's my floor plan on the map. It's not going to look exactly like in the original map, because the sheets are set up differently and the sheet effects are not copied over. But that doesn't matter. The only thing we need is the shape. And now we come to the functions of perspectives that make the conversion into an isometric map easy. Because we want this floor plan in the isometric view. And how to get it there? Well, perspectives has a function for that. So I'm just going to go over to the left toolbar here, where all the main tools for the add-ons, the current add-on, are. And I do have the 3D projection command here. That means I'm projecting a flat surface into the isometric view. And there's different ways to do that. Depending, do you turn the whole thing to the left, to the right? Are you projecting onto a vertical or a horizontal area? And we'll just do the horizontal area view from the top, counterclockwise as our base thing, the top left option. Okay, and now we need the thing we are converting over, and for that we're gonna select the floor. There we go. I see I have two entities selected down here on the left. That's because there's also, I probably also clicked the wall. So again, I'm gonna do combine not, and I don't want anything on the layer walls. We go and see now we have only one entity selected, which is our floor. And I'll right click, choose do it. I'm going to choose that left corner again, which is going to be my reference point for all my operations I'm doing. And you can see I've got the floor plan layout now in this isometric 3D view, and I can place that on the map. And as you can see, it's taken the bitmap texture from the original one and converted it to an isometric view showing the flagstones in this isometric angle. So that's the base we've got for our floor plan. And to make viewing the walls easier here, I'm gonna remove the original here, so it's not obscuring any of the other stuff anymore. So I'm going to do erase again on the left toolbar, a very common command to use. And again, I'm going to click the floor plan, and I don't want to delete the walls. Oh, that was the wrong combination. Let's do it again. Click the floor plan, combine not, and not the layer walls. See, the floor is gone. I don't need it anymore. I do have my isometric version already. And here is the rest of the map. So I could now go and convert over the walls over, but I'm not going to do that because I want to draw them in the isometric functions here in Perspectives 3 to show them to you. And it makes it easier to break them up into separate chunks. For that, we need to choose our walls and floor bitmap textures we want to use for the map. And for that, we are going to click here on the left toolbar, the topmost, the perspective settings. See, and this gives you different options of colors and textures. Different gray of rock or stone walls, wood walls. And I'm going to go for a brown wall here, stone wall. Because I'm just going to be drawing the the wall to start with, I'm not too concerned which option I've selected for the floor. I can always change that later. So I'm just going to click OK, and that's my options selected for the bitmap textures I'm going to be using. So I want to draw walls on the room now, and I've got on the left toolbar the wall here. You know, see if I just left-click that, it will give me the wall of the current thickness, so I can set the thickness to something. I can also right-click on the walls button to give me some pre-configured options. So I think a 1 foot wall might look quite nice. So I'm just going to go for that. And now I can start with the first end of the wall. One thing to note for drawing perspectives, drawings is always good to start from the back of your image or your building and work forward, because that will give you the correct order of things. And be a bit mindful of which walls overlap others and try to create them in separate chunks so you can order them separately. I'll show you in a bit. Let's just do the back wall basically first for the room. This is going to start here, I see I have the grid function on, that means my clicks will snap to the corners of the grid automatically, so I don't need to worry about exactly where my mouse click is going to go. And the last click is going to be here. And now I'm going to right click to finish this section of the wall. And now it gives me a height that the wall is going to be. You see the 6 in the parenthesis is the default option. If I right click that, it will make the wall 6 foot high. But that doesn't sound quite enough for a temple building. So I can either just click somewhere to fix the height of the map visually, or I can type in a new value for the wall. And I'm just going to go with something like 15, a high ceiling for the interior room. So let's do a 12 foot height for the wall. And there we are. There's our base wall. I'm going to do a couple more sections in separate parts. So I'm just going to repeat the command by left clicking. That will just repeat the last command I've been doing. And going to start adding a few more sections here until I get to the front of the building. See, the default value for the wall is now set to 12 feet because it always reuses the last one I'm used, so I can just right click and accept the wall height without having to enter a new height again. Here we go. That way we've got the back wall of the building. Now I'm coming to the front wall, and the front wall is always a bit problematic because if I'm drawing it at the full height, it will obscure a lot of the floor plan behind it because it's this isometric 3D view. So one trick or one common way to alleviate that is to draw it as at a reduced height and just imagine that it's been cut out to allow the view in there. So I'm just gonna choose or repeat the command. Gonna click and draw the wall. And I'm going to leave the bit for the front door here. And now I'm just going to do a 1 foot or 2 foot. Let's do a 2 foot wall height. This signifies that the wall is there, but I've got the full view into the building and the wall doesn't obscure anything. Same thing here on the other side of the front. Again, I'm just right-clicking for the height to use the same value again. And now I'm going to do a little bit for the doorstep, basically. I don't want to just leave that free gap here. So I'm just going to do the wall again. Draw in the wall section. And I was not correct. And I'm gonna do just a 0.2 height, so just a very low doorstep. There we go. Now, as you can see, I've drawn it in a slightly wrong order. The doorstep should be behind this foremost section of the wall. I can just simply fix that by going to the right side toolbar with the common catch tools here on the right, and I want to use the bring to front command because the wall I drawn earlier should be in front of everything else. So I'm just going to click that, select this wall here by clicking on the edge and then right click and do it, and there's my wall in front of everything else. Okay, so looks good. We've got an outline of the building in walls, with the walls. And I do now need the interior walls. I've got a few up here on the back of the floor plan. and I want to draw them into the floor plan as well. This is going to be a bit hard to draw just by hand. Judging, I might be able to do that, but it's a bit difficult. So I'm going to use the projection tool again to put the baseline of the walls into the floor plan. So again, I'm going to the left tool wall and choosing the 3D projection tool. Same option as before. And I'm going to select my walls here just by clicking the parts. Then I'm going to do right click and select do it. And the trick is to take the same origin point again as you did for everything else previously. Just click the lower left corner of the floor plan and the same corner on the isometric view. And there are my walls in the map. Now they're not that visible, or well, actually, oh, they work quite well. So I can now go in and draw my interior walls. And I'm going to choose this time I'm going to left click and choose wall, I'm going to right click and choose wall choose thickness. And I'm going to make the interior walls not 1 foot in width, but 0.5 feet. Go. And see, I can draw them in here. And I'm also going to do them at the 2 foot height, so they don't obscure anything. Come on. Oh, I've done something wrong here. Let's do it again. Choose thickness. Oh yes, I accidentally set a wrong wall width for the second piece of the wall I did. So there we go. And that's because if I just redo the command again, as I did before, it will prompt me for the wall width again. So instead, I'm gonna left click here and choose the current thickness, which will be the one we've set before. And the next bit here. And again, I want to do the door steps. So do this and a height of 0.2. We go on the last one down here. And now I do need to order everything a bit, because again, I've done the wrong order of drawing stuff. So I'm gonna just go through the bits of walls and front them as I go along. Oh, careful, I don't want to front the floor. There we go, this bit. And this wall. And there, everything is in the correct order again. And see, that's how you set up the interior walls for the building. So let's take a little break and have a look whether we've got any questions that I can already answer before I go too deep into the map. Yes, Joe asked whether the combined thing works on other overland maps and everything. It works with everything, really, as long as you know what you're selecting and what you don't want to select. The combine options in the editing tool are extremely powerful. They allow you to combine by a logical AND, logical OR, and I can really recommend looking into them. They are very powerful tool that will help you a lot when you get used to it. Chris also, after selected erase, could have just selected the P shortcut for prior and only the floor would have been erased. That would not have worked at that point because that was after I had done the projection command of the on the floor, and the prior selection would have selected the isometric floor I just had created and not the one I selected earlier for copying. So that's why I didn't use the prior editing function for that. Okay, hopefully that was clear enough. Let's get back to the map. We do have the, now we've got the symbols that we want to project onto the map. And let's take a look. I could go in and just fill them in by hand, but I do want to know roughly where they are. Well, I want to know exactly where they are and match the floor plan fairly closely. So again, I can use the projection tool. Same procedure again, same option. Select the symbols I want to project. I'm not going to use the doors because they are very, very obvious where they go, but everything else. Right click, do it. Click selection point and click on the same reference point in the isometric map. Ooh, you say this looks weird. Yes, it does. Because the symbols are just placed in their correct positions. They are not automatically, the external bitmaps cannot be affected by campaign cartographer internally here. So we don't have a proper projection of the symbols. But that's not what I wanted to do. What I wanted to do, I wanted to get the location where the symbols should be placed. And that's what these references give me. So I'm just going to load up the matching catalogs from perspectives and use those symbols. For that, I go up to the catalog toolbar, as you can see up here. That gives me all the symbol sets, symbol catalogs for perspectives like containers, magic things, furniture, or what I'm looking for now for is the temples and catalog. And here I'm going to look for some, scrolling down, for some pillars, columns. I've got a nice one here. And let's see, I can match that to the location of the flat symbol set 4 symbol here. It's a bit too small to match, so I'm just going to right click and set it to 1.5 the scale. That's much better match. And I'm just going to place them in the location that are indicated by the flat symbols. That's our pillars. Then we're going to need some benches. Loading up the furniture catalog. I've got some benches here. I can use just simple ones, but I'll go for the more ornate ones. Now I've got to need to set the scale back to normal, otherwise it will be too large. And the perspectives allows you to choose different orientated versions of the same object with the arrow keys. So I'm using the arrow keys here to choose between the four cardinal directions. And or I can also use tab to cycle through them. So this is the direction I want to place them in, and I'm just gonna use the existing ones as reference to place rows of benches in the map. Then we do need a statue. Of course, we're not using the same kind of catalog here, so I'm not find this exact same symbols as in the Mike Schley's symbol set. So I'm gonna have to make do and choose one of the statues that are included in Herwin Wieling's catalog. See, you've got the woman, the female statue here. So I'm gonna just increase the size of that a bit. This was done by holding down the control key and moving the mouse up. Go. Then we need an altar. Got a nice sacrificial altar here. It's a bit darker than the one we have in there, but that shall be fine. But I'm going to set it back to normal size. Might be a bit larger perhaps. There we go. And then we have a lectern there. There we go. Again, we can obviously you only have the four cardinal directions. You can't rotate symbols freely in perspectives because that will just make them look weird. If I show you, if I hold down shift to just rotate the symbol, you see it just rotates the basic bitmap and breaks the perspective isometric view. So we have to make do with the cardinal directions. There we go. There we go. That leaves us the stairs. For that, I'm going to again go to the catalog toolbar and choose the up and down catalog. And I see in this style I only have a spiral staircase, and the other staircases are wooden ones which don't quite match my original view of the floor plan. So I'm just going to do something odd and mix symbols from another catalog in here, because we've got the having Wheeling style and the other bitmap style in perspectives. So I'm just going to switch the catalog style. This is the old isometric view. You could the old vector catalogs. You could also use that. This is black and white, and here's the old the new bitmap style from perspectives, which I wanted to use because it's got some stone staircases. This looks about right. This style has the advantage that it has actually 8 different directions for each symbol. And this looks correct, but we do need a little bit smaller. Let's set it back to size 1. Could still be a bit smaller. This looks nice, and I'm going to turn off snap to place this by hand. There we go. It's close enough to the other symbols that I don't mind that these look a little bit different. If you do more mind that, of course, you can go with the wooden-looking stair sets from the Herwin Wheeling style. Finished. And the other nice thing, it does have an opening staircase leading down. I've got this one here that looks like a good fit for the staircase going down in this room back here. And now we're going to run into a little problem. If I'm going to place this in here, the symbol is just above the walls here. That's because in the perspective style these flat symbols would need to be behind the walls, but the sheet is set up differently. So what I'm just going to do here, I'm just going to move that symbol to a different sheet. I'm going to go to the toolbar on the left, go to the Sheets and Effects icon, right-click it, and choose Move to Sheet. Select my symbol, do it, and put it on the floor sheet. Refresh, and there you can see it's nicely behind the wall. Now I do need to get rid of the symbols, the old ones, which I just used for reference and which look wrong. And I could go in and try to select them all and delete them with the erase command. But since I don't need them anymore, I'm just going to do something different. I'm going to go up to the menu. I'm going to click Symbols, choose the Symbol Manager. And I'm going to choose all the flat symbols here that are shown in my list of symbols until I come to the first isometric one. Select them and delete them. And that way I just delete the symbol reference from the drawing. And as you can see, the symbols are gone. Go. And now I just need to add the doors for my building and perhaps put some windows into the walls. I'm going to zoom in And again, I'm going to go to the wall features catalog. And now I want to go back to my Herwin Wheeling style. And there we are. And here I've got a nice selection of different door symbols available. So I'm just set them back to normal size. And as you can see, these will are actually they are aligning to the grid now here, which is something I in this case don't want because it keeps me from aligning it correctly to the wall. So I'm just gonna go in and go to the properties bar, select the layers dialog, and hide the hex and square grid. And this way, arch it a bit. That's my main door to the temple. I did have a back door to the temple. Let's choose this one here. And then some interior doors. There's one, there's one. And this one is problematic because it's 90 degrees upwards, and because the symbol is flat, the door is simply not visible from the side. So I'll just leave it out here. It's not going to be a big thing. And finally, you see we have some overlapping different symbols, which just matches the questions I've seen that it would kill everyone's OCD, I guess. So we're going to fix it quickly. We're going to one nice thing you can do in perspectives, as long as you've got all the symbols on the same floor, you can simply sort them in the map. So I'm going back up to symbols, sort symbols in map, right click, select all, everything, right click, do it. And there the symbols are all sorted correctly. And you see the stair is probably behind the pillar. And I wanted to add some windows. I almost forgot. We've got some nice windows in the Herwin Wheeling style here. For example, for a temple, the stained glass windows. Back to normal. Oh, it's a bit large. Make it a bit smaller. Here we go. And with the, oh, okay, I should do that more slowly. With the, you see the symbol in the catalog is flat, just a flat on front view. But there are the wall symbols for the isometric styles, they align to floor wall lines. So if I move my mouse cursor over the wall edge here, you'll see that the symbol jumps into correct isometric perspectives. If I do the same up here, it jumps to the different, the doors also did that already. So, but the windows do in addition to that is if you click on the wall baseline, the next option is it gives you the distance from the floor that the window will sit. And you can adjust that manually visually, or you can just type in a value. I'll just do it visually here. The nice thing is, next window you do, you just right click and it will use the exact same distance again. Here we go. Then let's do a more standard window back here. Glass window. There we go. There we go. There are our windows. And there's our floor plan. Again, we can show our grid again if you want to. It's a square grid. If you do want the grid above the floor, as you see at the moment the floor is covering the grid, you can just move the sheet, the grid sheet a little bit down until it's just below the floor here. And now you can see the grid option on the floor. But I'll put it back into the standard location. Okay, so we've got the interior of our floor plan. I'm just gonna check for another question. The stairs had 45-degree options. Does the same symbol set have doors that do that for your one missing door? The problem is not that the option isn't there. That's the problem is that the doors are these automatically aligning symbols, and they just vanish on that exact 90-degree angle. But you can use them on differently if the wall would just be a little bit different in direction. Let me just show you. If I draw a bit of wall here, oops, what I'm doing actually should pick this, the width of the wall. Here we go. Click. See this very steep angle wall. If I choose a door on that, on this style or the other, also the other perspectives, the doors still align correctly through that angle, because that's not actually a different symbol. That's calculation that Campaign Cartographer does. But still, if the angle is exactly 90 degrees, the door will simply not be visible, because you can't see it, zero width door from the side. Okay, so much for that. And let's see, there's also a question about sheet effects. Yes, sheet effects work in perspective as well. They do need to be set up a little bit differently because dark shadows don't work that well and some other stuff. But if I turn on sheet effects, you'll see that there's outlines for the walls, little glows and things to make things stand out, be clearer. And there we go. Sheet effects work as well. They are just not as strongly used in perspectives. So we have the interior of the building, but I also wanted to show you the exterior of the building, because isometrics also has a building option. For that, I'm first gonna erase our remaining entities, and then I'm gonna do the outside of the building next to my floor plan here, and I'm gonna start by copying the floor over. So I'm gonna go over to my command toolbar, choose copy, choose the floor, and again use combine not. I do not want to copy this section of wall. Right click, do it, choose my turn on snap again, choose my reference point, and copy the floor over. This is just as the reference for my building. So how do I draw the building from that floor plan that I have? It looks pretty complicated. It's not going to be a simple four-corner building. So let's have a look. Here is my 3D house option on the left toolbar, and I start by right-clicking the tool to bring up the set house settings. And again, this is the colors and fill styles and setup for the textures that the building will use. So I'm gonna use the same brown wall as the interior, and a reddish brown roof building, a roof texture. And you'll see some options I'm gonna be using here in a moment, but let's just put down a first basic shape of the house. So I'm going to look at this with this tool directly. I can only draw a rectangular building, but the building I have is made up out of various rectangles, and I'm going to do the main square building as first. So I'm going to choose this as the first corner, this is the second, third corner. Now I set the height, the wall height. Again, I'm actually gonna go a little bit higher than the interior I've chosen. So I'm gonna go 15 feet high. Then I get the roof. which I can set the height as well. And here I'm gonna just go with the default of 6 feet. Obviously, I don't want this roof to be too steep. And then I set the angle of the sides of the roof. And for this, I'm gonna move them all the way to the middle so they meet and I've got a roof falling off into all four directions from the center of the building. Left click to finish. And there's my basic building shape. Now I've got these annexes here at the sides and I can draw these as well. Again, I'm gonna choose the right click the 3D house tool, and this time, because our two sides of the roof will not be the same, I'm gonna uncheck the both ends the same option. Click insert. I then do need to draw this side of the building that I'm drawing first. So this is the small section here and I'm gonna use the grid again to match these points. Floor, set the same height. Again, the height options give me the previously selected ones at the default, so the roof height is still 6 feet as default. I just right click to accept that value. And now I think we need to zoom in a bit to see this better. You see the shape outline of the roof, hopefully in the video. And normally you can just move the point inside the area of the building. But if you hold down shift, as the command says, tells you, allow outside, it allows me to move the roof in the other direction. And I can put it in a distance here or do it visually. So let's do it visually. Click. Oh, that was, I think I've done a wrong click here. I think I have to redo this one. See, I did want to turn the roof corner a little bit further to the right. So I'm just gonna undo by going to the left toolbar and choosing the undo option. And just gonna redo the whole thing. Again, I can see it better now because I'm zoomed in closer. Roof height, 6 feet. And now, the thing I'm doing is I'm forgetting to hold down shift while clicking. I need to keep shift pressed. That's better. And there's our little extension of the building. Gonna do the same on the other side. Again, choosing the default values. And there's our other extension of the building. Now you could go ahead and try the same on the back of the building. That's a bit more awkward because it overlaps in a complicated way. Basically, part of the extension would be behind the building and the other part of the roof would be in front of the building. It's doable. You have to take the piece apart a bit, but I'm not going to go into that. That leads a bit too far in this situation here. But let me, might be a good thing I can put up separately in a quick video to show that. But I don't want to get into that this here because I want to show you how to do another story on the building, another level. Because this is the floor plan we originally created had multiple floors and this seems to be only one floor and the building also still looks a bit simple for a temple. So what I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna add another building, again this time with both ends the same, on top of the existing one. Don't make it as high, just let's use 10 feet height for this one. again 6 foot roof height. And there's our upper story. It just hides the middle section of the roof. And let's do one more, a little tower on top. Go. This is, we didn't quite hit the correct point here. See that we made it a bit too wide towards the right. So I'm just going to erase that section again. Let's redo that. I'm going to can turn off the snap here. I just need to be careful to draw in parallel to the roof edge so they actually meet up to do that. I'm going to give this a try. I'm going to do I'm going to use the on modifier F9 to match this to the edge of the roof here, and then I'm going to use a modifier parallel 2 F11, something I don't use very often. So I want to draw this next section in parallel to this edge here. Looks like it doesn't work like that with the perspectives command. Too bad. So we've got to have to do it by hand. But again, I'm going to use F9. And you can see this didn't quite work as I intended. I can't match that up here. That's because this edge is not really in parallel to here. So let's redo that with a proper snap. That's going to work better. Just going to find the correct snap point. What I can do, I can draw it first and then move it later. That's going to be a good thing to do. Let's do the roof option. And now what I'm going to do, I'm going to select the house piece I've drawn. Move it from the point down here and move it exactly on top of the edges. There we go. That looks much better. And this is my exterior temple building. To some extent, let's move it a bit down so it's a nicely matches the outline of the floor plan. And now we can go on and add the doors and windows we need on the outside of the building. So let's do the double door. What I can actually do, I can just go in and say copy. Want this door. Select from this point. There we go. Actually, it's a bit too large, so I'm gonna scale it down a bit or move it down a bit. Oh, too much selected, and not only the door. Where's my door? That's my door on the temple. And let's add the windows. Got two windows on this side here, if it matches these windows up here. And let's do a few smaller ones at the front. And the upper story, that's a bit too high. Let's undo that. Redo the distance from the baseline of the wall. Zooming in is always a good idea. You're working stuff like this. This is actually hit the wrong line. That's why the window is aligned incorrectly. That's better. And a few windows up here. Again, I just should reset the distance from the baseline. And there's our temple building. And that's how you can create an isometric outside view from the same floor plan. And we can add some text, some labels. It was the Temple of Isis. And this is the first floor. Of course, we can also do the other floors, but that's not something I'm going to cover. Turn off the grid, and there's your map. Let's see whether we've got any final questions for the map. Joe asking about doing that in virtual tabletop on different layers to show one the outside first and then reveal the interior. That's obviously done better in the external, in the virtual tabletop environment. But to make sure that you've got this exactly the same size of your export, I would go ahead and add the same outline to the exterior view. Say let's copy this here, do it here, and now you know this is exactly the same size and you can export both as a rectangular section. Let's actually do that. Say file, save as, choose the JPEG option rectangular section. In the options, set the size, pixel size you want. Say I know this is a square map, I want 1200 by 1200 pixels. Save it. Select the corners. And this will bring up the export. In the exact same size if you do it for both sections, and then it's easy to put these on top of each other in your virtual tabletop environment of your choice. Yes, and I struggle with the selection problem mostly with isometric, because isometrics, you have so many different entities lying on top of each other and overlapping that it can be a bit hard to select exactly the stuff you need. But then again, I should probably hide and show the proper layers and use the layers more. But often enough, it's just a thing of a couple tries, and then you got the object that you really want. All right, that seems to be it in questions, and we've got the hour already finished, and so I hope you liked what you saw of Perspectives 3 and the option it offers. Very beautiful symbols and the nice isometric views you can create from your maps. And I'm going into a long weekend now. We've got a holiday coming up here in Germany, but I'm going to see you again next week with another live mapping video. Until then, have a nice rest of the week, and see you soon.